Thank you, Mr. Müller. Thank you, Mr. Pötzsch. I'd like to open it up for Q&A. Please wait for the microphone. First question, Mr. Krog, first row. Krog from Hamburg, Automobilwoche magazine. Mr. Müller, in the United States, there is still a diesel issue, and it seems to be particularly problematic in that particular market. Now, I'm sure you're not going to give us any details about the strategy 2025, but could you give us at least some indication? Can we expect that in the middle of last year, at the latest, you are going to focus on North America, or are you going to focus on other markets, for instance, the Asian markets? Follow-up question to you, Mr. Pötzsch. Is the supervisory board still trying to find a replacement for Mr. Warland, who did not take up his position as the designated head of the U.S. business? And another question, on one of your slides, it said that Oliver Blume is a guest. That's a quote, a guest in the group management board. Could I also be a guest? Of course, I'm just joking here. No, seriously.
In den Aufsichtsrat berufen, so wie Herr Müller, als er noch Porsche-Chef war, ja,
Anfang März dieses Jahres auch in den Konzern officially be gerufen worden made ist. A member of these supervisor. Ja,
herzlichen Dank, interessante Anregung.
Well, interesting questions here. Mr. Müller,
bis auf den Versprecher zum Schluss, also den Herrn Pötzsch, werden wir nicht mehr in den Konzern.
We're not going.
Sie meinten Herrn Blume.
You're talking about Mr. Blume, not Mr. Pötzsch. I think you mixed that up, that last part of your question. But anyway, I understand your point.
Ist so. Es war ja lustig.
There was a comment off mic. I'd like to come back to the first part of your question. You mentioned the Americas region and the focus we're going to place on the American market. Now, Volkswagen is a global company. And I think you mentioned certain deficits when it comes to opening up certain markets. Well, we do have those deficits, and you mentioned two of them. I could also mention AGGC. We're not particularly successful there. So over the next few weeks and months, we're going to take an in-depth look at all those markets. We're going to ask which brands should be successful on what markets, and of course, Volkswagen plays, or for us, America plays an important role, North America, South America,
and
all those regions which are currently in political difficulties. I mentioned South America, this is also true for Russia, and this is also true for other regions such as Iran. And you also mentioned a personnel question and also in connection with the United States, and I can say simply, yes. Of course, we were not happy that Mr. Warland did not take up his job. And of course, we are trying to find somebody else to fill that position as quickly as possible. Question regarding Mr. Blume. I'd like to take this opportunity to say that we are all very pleased that Mr. Blume was able to continue his career by acquiring the chairmanship at Porsche. Mr. Krug, you know that. Some things are standard procedure. And, some people attend meetings as guests initially, and when it turns out that they are mature enough, you take the next step. But there is really no reason to think about this at this point in time. Mr. Blume is looking back on a great career, and he's got a great career ahead. But I'm afraid journalists cannot take part in the group board meetings, I'm afraid.
absolut richtig. So, wir machen hier vorne gerade.
Okay, next question.
Wir gehen der Reihe nach durch.
Steve Fowler from Auto Express in the UK. Could you tell us and give us some details on what the effect on emissions, economy and performance will be of the software and hardware updates? Will your customers be better or worse off? And we've seen a very generous compensation package being offered to US customers. What sort of compensation package will be offered to customers in other territories?
Zum ersten Teil Ihrer Frage.
Well, the first part of your question.
Also so, dass wir natürlich Lösungen
you know, anbieten. The thing is, we're offering solutions, technical solutions, that do not impact the performance of our cars. If they do, that impact will be marginal and not marginal and negligible. You won't be able to feel it. Secondly, you mentioned some of the packages that we offer to our customers around the world. Now, it's important to emphasize that our customers are always at the focus of our attention, and we take care of all our customers. So we're working on an overall package for all affected markets and customers to make sure that this process is as pleasant as possible for the customers concerned. Also, it's important to emphasize that we are not going to charge our customers for what we need to do. We always said that, and that statement continues to be true. Okay, well,
Felix
Frieler
von DPA FX.
Felix Frieler,
ich habe eine ganze Menge Fragen, ich beschränke mich jetzt mal auf drei.
A range of questions. So I'd like to ask three of them.
Number one, Sie question to Mr. Pötsch. Vorstand über lange Jahre, Sie
You've
kennen
known
jetzt
the management board for many years, you now know the supervisory board.
Looking
back,
Vorstand und
as far as you're concerned,
gemacht,
what mistakes were made by the supervisory board and the management board? Mistakes that caused this debacle. Second question for Mr. Müller.
Also nicht die Auslieferung, sondern die Bestellung der einzelnen
How have orders, not deliveries, how have orders developed across the various brands? Can you give us any figures? And question number three, I don't know who would like to take that one.
Bei den Kosten für den gesamten
A question regarding the costs for this emissions scandal. When will you reach critical mass? In other words, when will costs be so high that you have to take consequences, for instance, by selling off certain parts of the company? Any estimates? Mr. Pötsch, would you like to go first?
Also, zunächst mal zu der Frage, welche Fehler sind
First of all, the question as to what mistakes were made. I think it has become apparent, at least from what we know today, that we can assume that a relatively small group of people actually made mistakes, acted irresponsibly, there are no indications that the supervisory board or the management board was involved. And of course, there's one question we have to ask, and that question is, what can we do to make sure that this never happens again? But first of all, we have to wait and see what the results of the investigation are going to be. As I said, our internal audit department is focusing very closely on possible improvement in our processes. There's a question without a microphone, apparently. The answer by Mr. Pötsch. Well, I think we should wait and see. First of all, we need tangible investigation results. Your second question had to do with the number of incoming orders, and I'm talking about the first 11 months of this year. As far as I'm concerned, the figures are quite gratifying if you look at the group as a whole. Incoming orders are 3.5% up year on year. And as far as our budget is concerned, even up 4.2% on our budget. So we can be quite satisfied with the current situation. As for the third part of your question, the possible sale of assets, well, as I said before, and I'd like to emphasize that there are no plans to sell any assets. We're a company with 12 very strong brands. We are happy to have those brands, and there are no plans to sell any one of them. In fact, there is no need to even think about this question. I know that some journalists disagree, but I cannot confirm their views. And I'm not going to speculate today and give you a figure about the possible damages we might have to pay. That remains to be seen. We just have to wait and see and then take it one step at a time, react appropriately, but we are firmly convinced that our liquidity and our performance is strong enough, so strong that we don't have to even think about this question. Thank you. Moving on in the first row.
Dominic Tobin from the Sunday Times. Could I ask how you came to understand how the Defeat Device software works? Did this come from individuals who coded the software, or have you had engineers combing millions of lines of software to discover exactly how this works? Secondly, could I also ask how Volkswagen will be going about reducing that discrepancy you mentioned between the emissions and the fuel economy in the real world and the test results?
Ja, Sie sprechen ein kompliziertes Thema an.
Well, what you're asking about is a complicated issue. Our experts looked at the software, they analyzed all of the relevant functions that have been part of the software for more than 10 years. And this has been a very time-consuming process. We have made a lot of progress, but the process has not yet been completed. As you said, we're talking about millions of lines of code, and that code needs to be reviewed. As for those differences, well, first of all, we have to accept that they exist. And I think I said in my presentation that we're looking at different engine variants, 1.2, 1.6, 2-liter versions across various generations over a period of 10 years, different versions in Europe and in the United States. And what this means is that we need different solutions for different engines and variants. Now, some variants can be fixed with a software update. In other cases, we might need a software package plus some additional hardware. I gave you an example, the six-cylinder TDI. We're going to replace the catalytic converter. So in some cases, the measures we have to take are manageable, but the hardware is more difficult. But as I said, all of these measures are currently being discussed with the US authorities. And as far as Europe is concerned, we know exactly what measures to take. And we're going to retrofit the affected vehicles in due course.
There's one also in the second row, please. Jürgen Gehmann, Norddeutscher
Rundfunk. Jürgen Gehmann from NDR.
Eine Frage zu Herrn Sanz. Sie haben gesagt, Sie haben mich mit der Aufklärung der Dieselthematik befasst. Da würde mich interessieren, warum Herr Sanz
you have appointed Mr. Sanz. Why is it? Why is it him? Was that something that the majority stakeholders has had wanted? Right? And the second question on jobs. Can you say anything in terms of the 2016 decisions to be taken on temp staff and core workforce? Is there anything you would like to share with us? As far as your first question is concerned, let me give you the background of that story here.
Den 20. September herum,
around the 20th of September, we were taken aback by the amount or the order of magnitude of the problems, and we had to establish a task force promptly, which will and had to deal with the management of this crisis, and that was done with Mr. Gunninger, our chief counsel or legal counsel. And let me also say that this team has been working day in, day out, day and night, in fact, and they have done an excellent job. But now we've come to a point where, let me be a bit colloquial by saying we see light at the end of the tunnel, right? And now we will invest more effort in managing this issue on a professional level. And a professional level presupposes that one of my colleagues on the board will be dealing with a top priority attitude, if you will. And as you've heard in my speech, we have been working a lot on realigning or reorienting this company, the group, and the structure, etc. So on the board level, we talked about the personalities of who could be in a position to head that process, who has the perseverance and the experience to carry this project forward, a very complicated and complex project. And this is how we agreed to appoint Mr. Garcia for the job. And this goes hand in hand with another professional appointment, which we have not mentioned, but has been, you probably have heard yesterday. Mr. Garcia transfers his responsibility to Mr. Brandstetter, the responsibilities for procurement, who will replace him on the procurement board member position. You also ask a question about the our workforce in 2016. Let me reiterate what I said before. Job security, stable jobs is key, and this is true also as we speak. Temporary jobs are a tool of ensuring flexibility. Now, that is not new. And if ever changes occur, changes to our production programs, then this can or may have an impact on the number of temporary workers. Let me repeat what I said before. On the group board level, every Tuesday we looked into this problem of crisis management and how we move this whole process forward. So it's an ongoing dialogue, and it has been a unanimous decision by the group board to appoint this person. Let's go to the third row, Mr. Doll, Mr. Fromm, Mr. Murphy.
Doll, die Welt. Eine Frage Doll an Herrn
from Die Welt. Question for Mr. Pötzsch.
Herr Pötzsch, Sie hatten von einer Kultur Mr. des Pötzsch, Akzeptierens von Fehlverhalten gesprochen.
About the culture of accepting faults or mistakes and in many areas like engine development, there was no two-man rule. And the idea to establish control over such processes has been obsolete. Now, for a company that has been a benchmark of the industry in many areas, that was astounding, wasn't it? So couldn't you also look at entirely different areas within Volkswagen, where also there have been violations, possibly infringements of applicable laws? So we're not just talking about emissions, but other things, because the industry is heavily regulated. There may have been infringements elsewhere.
Also, zunächst mal,
now, first of all, you have quoted me correctly, and when it comes to engine development, yes, we have identified deficits as part of our investigation and also after what our internal auditors have ascertained. There's no question whatsoever that this has been a situation for us to look very closely now and investigate on a, well, if you will, broad base. What does that mean? It means that we collect a large amount of data now. Data volumes are extremely comprehensive, and which will obviously delay our processes a little further or our investigation work. In other words, it requires a lot of time. But we do not want to select and pick out a few problems, but really we would like to be as broad-based as we can. Now, to put that into perspective, because the capacities to conduct those investigations is not endless, and therefore we have to establish a time frame or time schedule which identifies step by step the areas that are relevant and that we are going to scrutinize even further. That will reach into 2016 and 2017, of course. Now you can imagine, just to give you a number, that when it comes to auditing activities, more than 1,000 audits have already been planned for 2016. Thank you. Let's move the mic back, please, to Mr. Fromm.
Ja, Fromm, Süddeutsche Zeitung.
Mr. Fromm from Süddeutsche Zeitung.
Herr Müller, Sie waren in diesen Tagen
Mr. Müller,
einem Ihrer
these days you've just visited one of the large shareholders in Qatar, and there was some background talk about the shareholder not being entirely happy about the way Volkswagen has been structured, talk about employee participation, I think, or labor union co-determination. Is that right? Do they have a problem with corporate culture? And what was it that you discussed with your shareholders in Qatar? Question number two for Mr. Pötzsch. You'll have a new board member, the first lady to sit on your board, and the name has been given to, given to us before. What's your expectations that you have from Ms. Hohmann-Dennhardt? What is she supposed to do? What do you expect in this coming year, especially as it relates to what we can expect in the United States next year? So it seems, I think, that the biggest issues are still looming there in the background. And finally, sales or non-sales, Mr. Müller. You just said earlier that you have 12 brands, you're happy, and you do not expect that you have to divest anything. But we have the impression over the last couple of weeks that there are still parts within that 12 brand group that are more sacrosanct than others, or do you think all the kids are as endearing to you as all of them? Well, Mr. Fromm, we've been known each other for quite a while, so I can be a bit cheeky here. I, every morning, read what you write and what Mr. Doll writes and your colleagues, just to get just an understanding of what is happening, apparently, within the Volkswagen Group. And it was with great interest also that I read that we have been quoted to appear in Qatar, where we have been given a piece of their mind or being scolded at. You know, sometimes it's a far fetch. It's true. Yes, I was in Qatar in order to present myself in my new function, in my new capacity to the gentlemen there. And of course, it's quite normal that we discuss the current situation with them because they're very much interested in that. They want to know how we deal with this type of crisis and what are we planning to do going forward. Now, all I can tell you at this point is that the talks that we've had with our Qatari shareholders were based on a consensus and our broad-based confidence that we share efforts and that we share the view that our cooperation in the future will be intensified rather than be questioned in any way. Now, coming back to your third question, and this is also something I just only read in the newspapers, that there are some parts of the company that are more sacrosanct than others. Now, I'm amazed to hear that. Where did you pick that information from? doesn't certainly come from me, but it's nice for you to ask, so it gives me a chance to answer. And let me echo what I said earlier. It's not a second we possibly think about getting rid of any of those parts of this great company, which have made that group so strong, which until the 20th or the 18th of September, it was an outstanding group, also in your eyes, mind you. This has not changed, and this company is so great precisely because we have those 12 brands in our portfolio, and all of them individually are successful. So it is a successful group of a number of component parts that temporarily is in problems or is facing problems, but we are convinced that with the reforms that it takes and the personnel changes that we've made, we've already set the course for a better future. As Ms. Hohmann-Dennert is concerned, well, we're really glad it has been possible to get a professional for legal matters and integrity. On the 1st of January 2016, she'll resume her office. And basically, we're actually throwing a bridge to what we said earlier. Because when we say that we are investigating, we're clarifying things, we're looking into what has happened and why it has happened, how did people behave, etc. Now, all of that can be addressed from a different point of view or from a different angle, i.e., I think this is one of the main areas of expertise for Ms. Hohmann-Dennert, bring integrity into this company and establish a broad-based understanding. And she certainly doesn't start from scratch in the organization, but from what we have learned now, it's a good starting point for her job. Secondly, it's no question whatsoever that we will be facing litigation in the United States. Ms. Hohmann-Dennert has worked for another company in the past and has made an important contribution to organize these processes, let me put it like that, and I'm confident she will do that also in her function within our company to, in other words, establish a dialogue and a collaborative interaction with the authorities in a fruitful and appropriate way. Okay, let's continue with Ms. Wissenbach. Ms. Wissenbach, please.
Wissenbach von Reuters.
Ich hätte noch mal Fragen zu den Rückstellungen. Can I follow up on the contingencies, Mr. Percher, for the legal action, ensuing legal action? Is there anything?
Konkrete Rückstellungen vornehmen oder?
Is there any material reserves that you're going to make for these impending trials, possibly a legal action like an SE? Because it's not about the assumption of innocence at this point. And if so, if you make additional contingencies, when would that happen? And then another question for Mr. Miller. So far, you have not traveled to the United States to face the public there. Are you planning to do that, to be at the motor show in Detroit, to stand on your knees in front of the public? Let me take that first one, because you asked me directly. So far, we have not created any reserves or contingencies for any litigation on our balance sheet. Now, for you to imagine how this technically works, I think we've established a stringent process where all areas affected will be constantly monitoring whether there is a potential threat of litigation, because you cannot just create any random contingencies on your balance sheet. You can't. You just first have to check in your different departments, is there a relative risk of any such threat cropping up, and therefore, because there was no such risk in the past, no contingencies have been made. However, these cannot be ruled out going forward.
The fact of the matter is that
in the United States, the situation we're facing is that representatives of our group have admitted that we have engaged in wrongdoing and that illegal devices are installed in our vehicles, unlawful devices. And that already paves the way, if you will, for legal action. And we are monitoring that on an ongoing basis, and we could expect that at some point in time that will lead to a balance sheet item to reflect that legal risk. At the moment, it's premature to say that, whether that will be on our annual accounts or not. And you asked me the question of how about planning a visit to the United States. You're right. So far, in my capacity as chairman of the board, I have not yet been to the United States. First of all, we are negotiating on the technical solutions with the EPA and CARB. And for those meetings, we have appointed the best possible delegations of people of Volkswagen and Audi on the ground, and next week also more talks will be held. Now, once the conditions are there to engage in further talks beyond that, and we believe that this will be during the days after the Detroit Motor Show, then I will be scheduling a visit to America. Now, whether I'll be kneeling down or not, well, not for me to say at this point. I think I'll be self-confident in my in the way that I meet people there, and I, of course, will apologize for things that have occurred, but I'll be optimistic and quite confident looking into the future, because let me echo what I said before. Mistakes have happened. We will make sure they'll be investigated. We'll make sure it will never happen again. And Volkswagen also will be realigned to be prepared for that new and successful future, including in the United States.
Jenny Hill, BBC News, with a question for Herr Müller. Herr Müller, what are you going to do for the European customers who fear they're now stuck with a vehicle whose resale value is significantly lower than it was? Will you be compensating them?
Well, you're asking about the resale value of our cars, and of course we are looking into this issue. I think in my presentation I said that we're going to prepare the right package for each market, for all regions, and that obviously also includes the UK. Of course, it's got to be an attractive package. Some form of, well, let's call it compensation for a reduction in the residual value of a car. Yes. Moving on to the other side of the room, Mr. Kraut.
Volker Kraut, Autozeitung. Meine Frage an Müller.
Question to Mr. Müller.
Müller, haben Sie denn schon unter dem Aspekt möglicher Kosteneinsparungen ein abschließendes Bild, welche
regarding
Modelle zukünftig noch wirtschaftlich abbildbar sind, gemacht?
Which jetzt models ist der are still viable going forward? We know that the Phaeton has been eliminated. You're not going to launch another Roadster. Will there be further models? The future of the Beetle, of the Charan? Are you thinking about the future of those vehicles? And another question regarding a brand, but I'm not asking whether you're going to sell that brand. I'm talking about the Bugatti brand. Is it still the right brand for Volkswagen from modesty perspective, and also considering that, as far as I know, this brand has always had deficits. Your focus is going to be on electric motoring, so I think Bugatti is not going to be the spearhead. The 918 Porsche Spyder, I think, is a much better example. Well, thank you, Mr. Kort, for this very important question. The first is more important than the second. It keeps us busier, I have to admit that. Of course, we have to review the model lineup of the Volkswagen Group, but it doesn't make sense to pick out individual models. What you have to do is you have to look at the whole situation, the overall picture, and ask, how is the automotive world developing as a whole?
drive systems are an important question here. Secondly, the question is, how are we going to position our brands around the world, in the various regions of the world? And the third question is, what is the right product lineup at what point in time? Now, this is, as you can imagine, a relatively complex task. Over the past 10 weeks since I became the company's CEO, we didn't really have time to address those questions, and I told you that we needed to bring the right people on board, but now we have them. The right people are now on board, and in the first quarter, they are going to address exactly this question, and the results will be the basis for planning round 65 and also the basis for our 2025 strategy. So give us another 3 months, and then I'm sure we can get back to you with answers in the second quarter. As for Bugatti, well, you're taking me by my word. You mentioned modesty. When I said modesty, we've got to be modest. I was referring to our behavior. And there are customers in the world, very few customers I know, but some of our customers have the necessary wherewithals to buy those cars, and they want to buy them, so why not sell them to them? We've got the successor to the Veyron. It's ready, and in spite of all the prophecies of doom, we're going to unveil it at the Geneva Motor Show. Demand for this car is surprisingly high, as far as I'm concerned, and I can assure you, the second generation is not running up deficits, so I have a clear conscience, I sleep very well, but you are right, we have to review brands such as Bugatti. Or let me rephrase that. We have to ask about the products and which products will be profitable for those brands going forward. Let's go back to the first row.
Ralf Krüger, Deutsche Presse
Agency. A question to Mr. Müller. Earlier on, you said that the group is facing enormous costs. You don't really know how high those costs are going to be. What does this mean for your suppliers? Are you going to ask them to lower their prices, put pressure on them? Second question, the damaged image of the diesel engine. Do diesel engines still have a future going forward, seeing as their image has been tainted? And what about orders? You asked that question partly before. You said that the incoming orders are positive, but how did incoming orders changed starting in the month of October? Right, your first question, costs and our suppliers. Our purchasing chain is up and running. It works well. And it's not going to talk to our suppliers and mention the diesel issue and ask them to lower their prices. This is certainly not our style. Then the image of diesel engines, yes, this image has been tainted, you are right. We, Volkswagen, but also our competitors desperately need diesel engines in order to meet CO2 requirements in 2020. Now, you know that electric motoring is not quite as popular as anticipated or hoped for in Germany, even though the Volkswagen Group, among others, is offering a wide range of electric vehicles. So we're going to have to work on that, all of that, and the German VDA Association and also the ACEA Association is lending its support. It was a big issue last week in the board. We're going to launch a pro-diesel image campaign, and there is no reason whatsoever to make diesels, these high-tech products, seem bad if the NOx emissions are okay. And they are okay for the EU6 diesels.
We're talking about different regulations in the United States, different regulations in Europe, and the engines, which have caused the problems, are in some cases 10 years old. So I think if we all pull together, it should be possible for us to improve the image of diesel engines and to optimize them further. Diesels and petrol units alike, internal combustion engines in general, to close this gap between conventional drive systems and electrical systems. We've got to bridge and close this gap. And your third question referred to the incoming orders in the last month, the month of November. November saw very good incoming orders. This might partly be due to the fact that China is recovering, so we seem to be able to compensate some negative effects. In Germany, the Volkswagen Group is doing extremely well. There are countries such as Spain and France in Europe, which are seeing a decline in the number of incoming orders, but we are confident that this reluctance is going to change over the next few weeks. Moving on, next question in the first row, somewhere in the middle.
Nancy Holgrave from CNBC. Mr. Mueller, you've talked a lot about the complexities of finding a fix in the United States, but I'm wondering if you can give us specifically more details here on what's preventing U.S. officials from giving your fix the green light, because we know a proposal was presented on November 20th, yet no agreement yet. And can you say in complete confidence that a technical solution will be reached that is not cost prohibitive? And then just building on that, the longer it takes, the more hardship it's causing for your dealer network in the United States as well. So are you prepared to offer them more assistance, whether it's in the form of incentives or some financial aid?
Well, I know this has been a problem. We are impatient, we'd like to speed up the process, but we can't tell CARB and EPA when to set their deadlines, when to complete their analyses and come to an agreement with us. We are doing everything we can to make sure that we can complete this process as soon as possible, but I can't give you any more information, and I don't want to speculate, really. I can only say that we work extremely well with those two authorities, and over the next few days, at the latest over the next few weeks, I'm sure we'll have an agreement in place, and that will then be turned into a recall. I'm sorry, I can't give you any more details. Moving on to the other side of the room.
Hallo, Ingrid Hägermann von der Neuen Presse.
Ingrid Hägermann, Neue Presse. Question to Mr. Pötsch. You said there are no indications that Supervisory Board and Management Board members are involved.
Aufsichtsratsmitglieder, die vor 10 Jahren im
Amt also apply to Supervisory and Management Board members that were on the boards 10 years ago or over the past 10 years, and a question regarding the future positioning. You're trying to raise synergies. Where are they supposed to come from? I mean, you're using your modular toolkits. What other potential is there? And centrality and synergies, are these not mutually are these not contradictory, don't you think? Well, who is or was involved where and when? Let me say this again. We are conducting an extensive investigation. We're also looking at the history of the company. We're going back. We want to know exactly who is and was responsible for what at what point in time. So please ask that question again 1 month from now, once our investigation has been completed. And then we will let you know who was responsible for what. Mr. I think I have to answer the second part of the question.
The
new strategic positioning and the contradiction between centralization on the one hand and synergies on the other. I don't think that there is a contradiction. I think you can do both. Decentralization essentially means empowering the brands in terms of their day-to-day operations. However, that does not mean that you can't get together and plan the long-term future of the group. That's one way to raise synergies. Mr. Kork mentioned one example, and that is the product lineup for the next 10, 15 years and the right drive systems for that lineup. Once we have that, we can decide who is going to do what. You said yourself that our modular toolkits are doing well, but that doesn't mean that everything is set in stone for the next 10 years. We are reviewing things, we have to develop them further, and we are confident that we can raise further synergies.
Ja, Mr. Hapke, NDR Fernsehen,
from NDR Television,
zwei Detailfragen zunächst an two Herrn
detailed
Pötzsch.
Questions to Mr. Pötzsch. On the one hand, you said you can't give us any names. On the other hand, you said that apparently only a small group of engineers was involved. Which area of the company knew about this cheating software systematically? Is it engines development? Is it diesel engines development specifically? Which area in the company knew about what was going on? Second question, it was decided to develop a diesel engine for the US market. And I think right from the beginning, it must have been clear that the US rules and regulations could only be complied with if you use the SCR catalytic converter in connection with AdBlue. Have you found out when this decision was taken by which body? The decision to do it without any SCR catalytic inverter and without any NOx trap. After all, this is an ambitious, or was an ambitious target. You said you knew at the time it's difficult to achieve it. And question to Mr. Müller. A question regarding your task as you see it. You said you would like to focus more on the company's strategy. Now, this company is developing engines, and apparently at the time it was known that it was not possible to develop an engine on time, an engine that complies with the necessary rules and regulations. Is that a piece of information that you would like to be informed about going forward?
Now, first of all, we're talking here about engines or engine issues that are related to engine development, and where we well, attach great importance to scrutinizing those departments, i.e. those technical functions that have developed engines, right? I mean, that is a proviso, and can I ask you for your understanding at this point that we would like to continue this type of investigation, and then once we have results, we will present them in one go, as it were, and then we'll also make a separate statement about them. And that, in fact, is also true for the different committees that will have to deal with it and have possibly dealt with that in the past. So basically, it goes back to the question of who is in charge of what, and we'd let you know in due course. Point number two, or second part of your question, you called me a strategist. Well, I'm not sure I'm a strategist. I mean, it's for you to say, but I would imagine to see a company here where in the future no such things can happen again, where we have an end-to-end information flow which is well organized, where in the future we will not only apportion blame and find the culprits, but rather jointly look for the best solution. And I think here comes what is really important, that information, when we get it, must not be just a one-off publication that trickles down somewhere and then disappears from there, but anything, any information we find, any information we yield from this analysis must also be established on hierarchies that normally do not deal with those questions, right? So everyone in this organization must be in a position to analyze the gravity of a problem. I don't know if that's understandable how I phrased this issue. As a member of the board of management, you get dozens and millions of emails every day, and obviously this raises our awareness to what is really at stake. But there are things that you don't have the time to read, and you do not get the gist of it even, because there's too much information and it's not structured and addressed to those people who should know. And this is why we're ever so astounded why this has happened. Why could something like that have happened? Apparently, because information was not shared, it stayed within a small circle of people or engineers, and we have now stepped up this investigative effort. Up today, to this very date, we have to say that call it the triangle, the Bermuda Triangle, something may have happened within that smaller scale. Now, I know you'll be angry at me when I'm telling you that we only have time for two questions now. We have to start in the middle, in the front, because we had an earlier question. Then comes Mr. Murphy, please.
Hello. Ich hätte zwei Fragen, und zwar zum einen,
well, two questions, please.
Sie haben ja einige Veränderungen.
For one, you also have made some changes already below the board level, strategy and digitalization. And do you to take any additional steps in terms of digital transformations or any changes to that team, to the digital team? And you also said you have been done excellent progress with the collaboration of the U.S. authorities. That apparently has not always been the case in the past. So how has that good cooperation been borne out, come to fruition? And when you go to the U.S., do you travel to the Detroit Motor Show, or will you be later there after the show? Can you clarify that again? Well, I said I'm going to Detroit. That's what I said. And as far as I know today, from Tuesday to Friday, I will be traveling the United States during that time and meet the authorities there. Number two, or it rather was your first question, what should the design and structure of my function be, or of our departments related to my function? So that restructuring has been largely finished. I have to reappoint one more position, which is quality assurance, but all the other job positions have now been filled, also marketing and sales, production, those have been filled now. And the same is also true for the product and the modular strategy, which means that on the after the 4th of January, we're fully operational. And there, I'm quite confident to say that I found a team there that is really top flight. And therefore, it is true, I hope, that we will do an excellent job. What was the second part of your question again? Can I ask you? Collaboration with the United States? Well, you know, if there's two that don't get on with each other, that's because either of them are to blame. There may be misunderstandings, there may be incorrect interpretation of information, be it as it may. I do understand that the American authorities were a bit disappointed or cross at what we did, because they believed they had given the right information, which they have indeed shared with us. And then it takes me back to what I said earlier. For some reason, in Germany and in our company, apparently that information hasn't arrived in the place that it should have arrived, or it has not been interpreted the way that the Americans have meant it to be interpreted. Now, fortunately, that has been solved now. We are in a very factual and collaborative mode of engagement, which had been the case in the past, in fact. So this already now is a good condition, a good prerequisite for our ongoing discussions and also finding an agreement that will help us to know how we're going to to develop in the future. And hopefully also we want to establish and to continue to offer the diesel engine as a successful product in the United States. Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Müller, Mr. Pötsch. Unfortunately, I'll have to end this press conference now. It's too bad, says Mr. Müller. Not because I want to annoy you in any kind of way, but we have more appointments later on today. And also, finally, we talked about Detroit a number of times. On the traditional group night on Sunday, we will be available for your questions in Detroit and also in the following weeks as well. For the time being, thank you very much for taking the time to travel to Wolfsburg, and I'll be looking forward to meeting you again to discuss those issues going forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Bode, and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sure I'm not giving away any secrets when I say that the past 2.5 months were something that no one has ever experienced at the Volkswagen Group. That holds true for all of us, the supervisory board, the board of management, and the employees. No one here could have imagined that our company, a company where so many people give their best day after day, a company that is a source of pride to so many here in Wolfsburg and at the sites all over the world, could end up in a situation like the one we've been experiencing since the end of September. We're all not only deeply shocked by the events surrounding the emissions issue, but these events have also put the group in a very difficult situation. Mr. Müller and I would like to update you today on where we stand with regard to overcoming this crisis, what steps we have already taken, and how the Volkswagen Group is driving its renewal forward. Ladies and gentlemen, Volkswagen relies on the trust of its customers. Our customers not only expect to travel from A to B safely, comfortably, and efficiently in one of our vehicles, they also, quite rightly, expect that the emissions produced by the vehicle on their journey do not exceed the thresholds set. And as it turned out, that has not always been the case for our vehicles. We deeply regret this. And I'm not only speaking on behalf of Mr. Müller and myself, but also on behalf of the entire company. As a result, we have lost trust, the trust of our customers, investors and employees, as well as the trust of politicians and the public. Our most important task and our biggest challenge now is to win back that trust. That is why we must continue to act with credibility and determination so that we can deal rigorously with the mistakes of the past and make sure something like this never happens again. We owe that not least to our customers. At the same time, we must protect our operational business and defend our strong market position. Now, given the circumstances, that is not an easy task, but we are optimistic we can make it with our team. And in all these efforts, we must also safeguard the group's future success. On the one hand, in financial terms, because the fallout from the crisis will probably be considerable. And on the other, we must systematically continue with the ongoing change process to prepare Volkswagen for the upheavals faced by our industry. In a nutshell, and this much is certain, we are in the midst of one of the greatest tests in the history of the group. It will take an enormous effort on the part of everyone to pass this test, and we are all ready to play our part. It goes without saying that the supervisory board at times like these is supporting the board of management even more closely in its work. Moreover, the Supervisory Board has undertaken many initiatives of its own in recent weeks to take the process of clarification and realignment within the Volkswagen Group swiftly forward. First of all, I would like to mention the new management structure, which we signed off on September 25th. The Volkswagen Group will be decentralized to a greater extent in future. It will be more efficient, faster and more dynamic, so that the group will be able to leverage its enormous potential even more effectively. We've also speeded up staff reorganization in the group. Without this realignment, the changes we envisage would not work properly. We have not only recruited new, renowned experts from outside the company, but also have also given some of the best minds from within our group new responsibilities. There are six new members in the Board of Management since early 2015. That shows how thorough this new realignment is. In addition, there are new top positions, Mr. Müller will give you the details later on. In addition, the Supervisory Board has engaged to a greater degree in dialogue with our stakeholders. Now, in particular, we need support and goodwill from outside our company just as urgently as we need the commitment of all those in the position of responsibility within the group. We are soliciting support wherever possible. Ladies and gentlemen, what's important is that the Volkswagen Group is fully able to act in these very turbulent times. This company has a very solid foundation and many strengths that we can build on for the future. How and when we rise to those challenges is primarily, but not entirely, up to us. This also applies to the way we approach the clarification of the emissions issue. We want and indeed we must understand exactly how this could happen. That is the only way we can prevent anything like this from ever happening again. We have made a good deal of progress in this regard in recent weeks, and I would like to bring you up to date on what we have achieved so far. Allow me to recap. We are dealing with two very different issues. The first concerns up to 11 million of our diesel vehicles, which are fitted with a software program that systematically influenced the measurement of nitrogen oxide emissions. The second issue of recent weeks relates to CO2 emissions and the associated fuel consumption levels. During the critical review of our processes as a result of the NOx issue, information from an internal source drew attention to implausibilities in CO2 certification. This was immediately and proactively communicated on November 3rd. At that time, we announced that around 800,000 vehicles could possibly be affected. We were concerned that the certification of these vehicles may have been deliberately based on incorrect emission data. Since then, as we announced yesterday, it became apparent that this assumption was wrong. The suspicion of unlawful changes in fuel consumption data for current production vehicles has not been confirmed. Slight deviations were only found for a very small number of models, which will now be adjusted in the course of normal processes. That is good news for our customers and for the company. I will come back to this point in more detail in a few moments. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a clearly defined approach and goal for clarifying all aspects. Everything must be put on the table and nothing will be swept under the carpet. That means there must be a comprehensive analysis of what happened. So all the relevant processes from the source to the present day must be fully traced and analyzed. It is essential that these investigations are absolutely independent. That applies to the internal specialists we have entrusted with this task. Their mission is to investigate in all directions, regardless of personal reputation and with no taboos. Obviously, the same applies to the external specialists we have retained. In all our efforts, we are cooperating fully with the relevant authorities. We have repeatedly emphasized, and I'm doing so again today, that we are relentlessly searching for those responsible for what happened. And you may rest assured that we will bring these persons to account. It is precisely because we are dealing with people and because exhaustive clarification is so important for the future of the company that diligence is absolutely imperative. Even though it is sometimes difficult for you and for us to remain patient, diligence takes precedence over speed. We're looking for definitive answers to the following questions. Exactly what happened and when? We must trace the processes and the decision-making paths. Were regulations or laws broken? And if so, which ones? To what extent did our internal processes encourage possible infringements? We expect this to give us an insight above all into where we need to make improvements. Who is responsible for the misconduct? This is not only about direct responsibility, but also about overall responsibility. And finally, how do we make sure that nothing like this ever happens again in the Volkswagen Group? Looking to the future, that is definitely the most important question. We have structured the clarification process in such a way that we can provide a reliable answer to each of these questions. As you're aware, the work on clarifying these issues is being monitored by a supervisory board special committee chaired by Dr. Wolfgang Porsche. Since it was inaugurated on October 27th, the committee has met 5 times, so it closely follows the work of the investigators. There are 2 parallel threads to the investigations themselves. As mandated by the Supervisory Board and the Board of Management, internal auditing is focusing on examining the relevant processes, on reporting and control systems, and on the accompanying infrastructure. Internal auditing is making its entire findings available to the experts at Jones Day. This internationally renowned law firm, commissioned by the Supervisory Board to fully clarify the matter and identify those responsible, is following the second thread. This includes the forensic investigations. The audit firm Deloitte is providing operational support for Jones Day. In total, some 450 internal and external experts are involved in the investigations. The sheer number is an indication that we are taking this very seriously and are seeking conclusive results as quickly as possible. Both teams of investigators are working independently of each other. That is fundamental to objective clarification, something we as a company are very keen to achieve, even if some of the findings could prove painful. To ensure that internal auditing operates independently and is fully functional, we have brought together the best experts from various units and brands within the group and formed a task force with a predefined, clear mission of a specific duration. When their work is completed, the members of the task force will return to their usual duties. Incidentally, that also applies for the head of this mission, Markus Ebel, from Porsche AG, who has been assigned to Volkswagen for the duration of this mission. In this way, we can ensure that no personal interdependencies or misguided considerations obstruct clarification or distort the findings. Incidentally, a representative of Jones Day is also a member of the internal task force, a further guarantee for the independence of that task force investigations. All in all, we believe the dual structure of the investigations guarantees maximum objectivity, transparency, and quality of results. There are two different scopes to the internal and external investigations. That is why the amount of time they need for their work differs. The analysis of the relevant processes and systems conducted by internal auditing will be concluded soon. The work being undertaken by Jones Day, on the other hand, will continue well into next year. That is, as we will explain in a moment, partly due to the fact that the external investigators have to sift through a gigantic volume of data. It is also explained by the fact that we also need to clarify who is legally responsible for what happened. So this investigation must not only be plausible and consistent, it must also stand up to scrutiny in court. We plan to report on the status of the investigation at the annual general meeting on April 21st, 2016. But we would like to give you some initial information today and share the findings made so far with you. Before we do that, though, I trust you will understand that we cannot and will not be commenting on the people involved. We can only do that once the findings are absolutely watertight. Until such time, these people will be innocent until proven guilty. After all, we live in a state of law. In principle, what may be called the essence of what we have found out so far is that the NOx issue is the result of the interaction of three factors. First, individual misconduct and personal failures on the part of individual employees in one area of our company. A factor that can at best be contained, but can never be entirely eliminated in a group the size of Volkswagen. Second, flaws in some of our own processes. And third, an attitude in some units of the company that tolerated breaches of rules. That is apparently what happened in this case. And I freely admit that is the factor we all find the most difficult to accept. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to make one comment before I look at the findings of the internal audit in more detail. We widened the scope of the investigation in addition to the NOx issue once we found indications of irregularities in the CO2 certification process. Now that the CO2 issue has largely been concluded, we can once again concentrate fully on the nitrogen oxide issue. The areas investigated by internal auditing can be roughly divided into three clusters. First, processes, second, reporting and control systems, and third, infrastructure. The objective when analyzing the processes was to establish the exact sequence of events, or, in other words, to answer the question, what happened when? Today, we know that procedural problems encouraged misconduct. This applies, for example, to the test and approval processes for our engine control units. They were not suitable for preventing the use of the software in question. Internal audit has proposed specific remedial measures to remove these flaws. They focus on structuring processes more clearly and systemizing them better. For example, in future, the belt and braces principle will be strictly applied to the development of engine control units. At the same time, the committees responsible for the approval of such software will be reorganized with stricter and binding competencies and responsibilities. Even though we cannot prevent misconduct on the part of individual employees once and for all, in future it will be very difficult to bypass our processes.
Beim zweiten Themenfeld geht es darum, Defizite
in second area involves exposing deficits in reporting and control systems and identifying breaches of existing rules. Here too, there were undoubtedly shortcomings. This was mainly due to the lack of a concrete definition of responsibilities. Here, we must and will tighten things up. The internal audit also uncovered shortcomings at some points in our infrastructure. For instance, some of our IT systems are inadequate. Obviously, an infrastructure that does not serve its purpose is not particularly useful. Going forward, we will be installing IT-supported processing and control systems in the relevant areas that interact seamlessly with our workflows. We'll be introducing IT systems that make it possible to track individual events more efficiently and with greater transparency. At the same time, that reduces dependence on individual persons when identifying and possibly escalating problematic events. That means we should be better equipped to identify malfunctions in good time and nip negative developments in the bud. To sum up, the investigation by the Internal Audit Department delivered valuable findings for us to create a framework at Volkswagen where breaches of rules like those we found in one area of the group are not encouraged but prevented or at least recognized. Ladies and gentlemen, as I already mentioned, the external investigators from Jones Day are also making good progress, but still need more time. In order to arrive at meaningful conclusions on accountability, they have to systematically plow their way through enormous volumes of data. That includes, for instance, innumerable emails, each one on its own, is just a loose end in the chain of communication where the context first has to be established. So you can imagine how fragmented and complex this forensic work is. Now, to illustrate my point, here are some figures. So far, the specialists have sorted through 102 terabytes of data. That is the equivalent of roughly 50 million books.
An die notwendigen Informationen zu kommen, wurden bis dato
87 extensive interviews have been conducted to date in order to obtain the necessary information, and many more will follow. More than 1,500 electronic storage mediums, such as smartphones and laptops, have been secured from almost 400 employees.
Etwa 2,000 Mitarbeiter wurden per Schreiben darauf hingewiesen,
around 2,000 group employees were informed in writing that they have to make sure that they do not lose any data. The English term is litigation hold. Now, I'm not saying that all of these people are under suspicion. What it means is that on their computers, SIM cards or USB sticks, there could be information that might be important for understanding circumstances better. We still believe that only a comparatively small number of employees was actually actively involved in the manipulations. What we have learned from the material that has been reviewed so far is, first, we have a better understanding of the CO2 issue and how to achieve a swift solution, and second, we are better able to understand the origins and genesis of the NOx issue.
Auf den beiden folgenden Seiten der Präsentation.
The next two charts present the NOx issue in greater detail, beginning with the strategic decision to launch a major diesel campaign in the USA. I would simply like to give you a brief summary. The key finding is that we are not talking about a one-off mistake, but a whole chain of mistakes that was not interrupted at any point along the timeline. Looking back, we regrettably have to recognize that the developers involved in the EA189 project quite simply could not find a way to meet the tougher NOx limits in the United States by permissible means. Or at least they could not find a way they felt at the time to be meaningful and that fitted the time frame and the budget they had been given. So a software was installed that regulated nitrogen oxide emissions by various means, such as adjusting exhaust gas recirculation levels, depending on whether the vehicle was on the road or on a test bench. Later down the line, when effective technical solutions to reduce NOx became available, these solutions were not in fact used as they should have been done, apparently in the mistaken interest of customers. Once again, the engine management software delivered the supposed solution. The software features included the ability to vary the AdBlue dosage level. As a result, NOx levels on the test bench were particularly low, but they were significantly higher on the road. With hindsight, this all sounds almost a little banal, but that is perhaps why we find the whole thing so painful, not because the decisions were wrong, but also the premises and the priorities on which they were founded. All this goes against the values of Volkswagen and the values by which the vast majority of our 600,000 employees act day in, day out. There are always occasions when there is not an immediate perfect technical solution to a problem. That is when you have to keep working on the problem, take a frank and open look at conflicting interests, discuss alternatives, and possibly even totally rethink. What's definitely unacceptable is a superficial or even an illegal solution. No business can justify transgressing legal or ethical boundaries. Every single employee at Volkswagen must embrace that creed. We still do not know whether the people who've been involved in this issue from 2005 to the present day were fully aware of the risks they were taking and of the potential damage they could expose the company to. But that's something else we're going to find out. Ladies and gentlemen, apart from the smaller diesel engine, the V6 developed by Audi has also come in for scrutiny in the United States. There is, however, one fundamental difference. The crux of the problem for the Volkswagen EA189 engine is that the vehicle had two different exhaust strategies, one for the road and another one for the test bench. Now, that is not the case for Audi's V6 engine. Based on the same operating conditions, the warm-up strategy and the operating strategy are identical, regardless of whether the vehicle is on the road or on a test bench. The so-called AECDs, which stands for Auxiliary Emission Control Device, in the V6 engine that have come in for criticism in the United States are not currently subject to registration in Europe. However, under valid U.S. legislation, one of these devices could be considered to constitute a forbidden device. Audi will be presenting a technical solution to CARB and EPA and implementing this solution as swiftly as possible once it has been approved. Exactly when this will be the case has yet to be finalized. And I would like to point out that we're talking about some 100,000 units, so the scale is significantly more manageable than the scale of the original diesel issue. The situation with regard to the CO2 issue is entirely different yet again, as regards both the origin and the solution. As I already mentioned, based on the information we had, it appeared that a total of some 800,000 vehicles from various brands and models could have been affected by deliberate incorrect CO2 measurements.
Wir haben daraufhin damit begonnen, die möglicherweise
betroffenen Modelle systematisch durchzutesten. We immediately began systematic testing of the models that might possibly be affected. We also reviewed the measures and standards applied during testing. Our findings, first, the suspicion that the fuel consumption figures of current production vehicles had been unlawfully changed was not confirmed. Second, Volkswagen's measurement procedure conforms to the industry standard and is based and guided by the relevant international standards. And third, the remeasurements established that the actual consumption values for almost all of the current production vehicles are in fact in line with the catalog figures and correspond to the original CO2 and fuel consumption figures respectively. The measurement checks only established slight deviations from the catalog figures amounting to a few grams for nine vehicle models.
Für diese Modellvarianten der Marke Volkswagen läuft nun eine unabhängige Überprüfung durch die DEKRA.
DEKRA was commissioned by the industry regulator KBA as a technical service provider to perform an independent review for these Volkswagen brand model variants. With an annual production of approximately 36,000 vehicles, these model variants correspond to around only 0.5% of the Volkswagen brand's annual production volume. Based on the findings of this official remeasurement, the CO2 and fuel consumption data will be updated, if necessary, at the earliest possible opportunity in line with the usual processes. It's important to bear in mind that the estimated 2 billion euro negative impact on earnings initially attributed to the CO2 issue has not been confirmed. That is good news for the Volkswagen Group. We know that the CO2 issue has been a cause of considerable concern for many of our customers. So the latest developments are very good news for them.
Nennenswerten Steuereffekten wird es aus heutiger Sicht
as things stand at the moment, any impact on tax seems unlikely. And if back taxes should be levied, Volkswagen has already given an undertaking to pay them. Ladies and gentlemen, tracking processes, identifying mistakes and establishing who is responsible, that is only part of the exercise. The other, much more important part, looks towards the future. Drawing the right conclusions from past mistakes and taking all the measures necessary to prevent something like this from ever happening again. We have already begun to put this part into practice too. Let me begin with the most important of these landmark decisions for Volkswagen. We have decided that our emissions tests will in future be verified by external and independent third parties. We will also be introducing universal on-road emissions measurements during real-life driving. We hope that will help us win back trust. I would like to make one comment at this point. When it comes to thresholds, we need the courage to be more honest. The growing industry-wide discrepancies between official emissions data and real-life levels are no longer acceptable. We need to break new ground here. Implementation of more measures out of the 30 or so measures identified by internal auditing is already underway. All the findings from the internal audit will be submitted to Jones Day and therefore help clarify who is responsible. And finally, as far as responsibility is concerned, the first step was to suspend nine managers possibly involved in the manipulations. I do not intend to speculate on whether there will be further personnel consequences, and if so, what they could be, but I can guarantee that we will take this relentless clarification to its final conclusion. This is the foundation for the renewal of the Volkswagen Group, which has already begun. I am committed to this. The entire supervisory board of Volkswagen AG is committed to this. And with that, I'd like to hand over to Matthias Müller.
Vielen Dank, Herr Pötsch, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pötsch, ladies and gentlemen. Clarification is indeed a key building block for the task that lies ahead of us. And it is something that my entire board of management team and I myself have committed to. Because if we draw the right conclusions from past mistakes, Volkswagen will only be a better company, truly, and this is what we're working towards. And we're determined to restore Volkswagen excellent reputation, and we will do so. We will, and we want to lead this great company into a better future. There are many facets to this task. You may recall that I presented a five-point plan for the realignment of the group back at the end of October, and for me, all the five priorities are equally important. The first priority on this list is to provide effective technical solutions for our customers. And of course, our customers also want to know how these manipulations came about, and more particularly and rightly so, they want us to put their vehicles to rights as quickly as possible, and I'll come back to that in a moment. Now, then Mr. Pötsch has already talked at length about the second priority, establishing the truth, and obviously it has very high importance for us in the Board of Management. And that is why we have done everything in our power to make sure that internal auditing could really work as independently as possible. And let me also add one more point. When in early November we uncovered implausibilities in CO2 data for some vehicle models, well, that certainly did not make any situation any easier. The fact that this was uncovered by our own investigations and that we went public at a very early stage, that also demonstrates that we are absolutely determined to engage in this process of what we call clarification and transparency. May I also make one more comment here at this point. As we have announced yesterday, we have assigned operational responsibility for the full clarification of the diesel issue to my colleague Francisco Javier Garcia Sanz. So, it is in very good hands indeed. At the same time, by appointing a group board member for this task, we are actually documenting how important it is for us that we make progress swiftly. Points number 3 to 5 on my list of priorities all relate to the fundamental realignment of the group that we have already initiated. We are renewing our structures, we are renewing our mindset, and the way we do things. And we're also redefining our targets. In other words, we're evolving our strategy for the next 10 years. These 5 points also have a double message to them. We're doing everything we can to overcome the present situation. But we will not allow this crisis to paralyze us. Quite on the contrary, we are using it as a catalyst for change that Volkswagen needs. For me, it's important to make clear that this five-point plan is not a declaration of intent. It sets the guidepost for our actions. It is truly our agenda. It's our yardstick, if you will. That holds true for Volkswagen, but this is also true for me personally. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Pötsch has already set out the details of how we're putting our words into action as far as we're getting to the bottom of events. In the following, what I'd like to do is to explain to you how we're working on all of the other issues with the same intensity. Let me therefore begin with an outline of the technical solution for our customers, who are truly at the center of everything we do at Volkswagen. For all the three European variants of the EA189 engine, we now have robust solutions. And we have also received the all-clear for all of these solutions by the KBA, the Federal Motor Transport Authority. In other words, that means that we can make sure that all of the models affected in Europe will have one and the same emission strategy on both the testbed and in real-life driving. And of course, they now
naturally also comply with all emission legislation. Also, the outlay for implementing the solution in terms of technology, in terms of workshop time, is financially manageable. May I also take a moment to thank our engineers who have quite literally been working day and night for weeks now. And on behalf of the entire Board of Management, and also in my own name, I would like to express our thanks and our appreciation of their work. Now, just a quick word about the solutions themselves. The 2-liter TDI and the 1.2-liter TDI only need a software update. For the 1.6-liter TDI, a flow transformer will also be fitted in front of what is called the air mass sensor. This flow transformer improves the measuring accuracy, and then when combined with a software update, it optimizes the injection volume of fuel injected, and that is a factor that has a significant impact also on the production of nitrogen oxides. Now, you and your colleagues have written much about this solution and the what is called mesh that involves. And we keep on hearing the same question. Well, if the solution is so simple and inexpensive into the bargain, why are you only fitting it now? The answer is just as simple. First of all, this technology was not available at the time when the A189 was developed. And second, a retrofit wasn't on the agenda until quite recently because no one knew that there was a problem with the EA-189. So, now that all the solutions for Europe are on the table, we can get to work putting them into practice. We are beginning now next month with the recall of the 2-liter TDI, which is the variant that has the highest number of vehicles affected. And the recall for the 1.2-liter TDI is scheduled to start in the second quarter of next year, and then the implementation phase for the 1.6-liter models is planned for the third quarter of next year. Now, this is the last model we recall, because we need an appropriate lead time for sourcing and producing the hardware that we require. As plans stand now, the entire campaign will take the whole of next year. Now, the recall obviously poses an enormous logistical challenge, but our aim is still to have completed the retrofits by the end of the year, if possible. By the way, can I remind everyone that owners do not have to contact us. Each owner will be informed whenever their vehicle will be called for the update, so they will receive that information directly. Ladies and gentlemen, the situation in the United States is unfortunately more complicated than it is in Europe. That is in part due to the much tighter nitrogen oxide levels on the other side of the Atlantic. So, retrofitting the vehicles there to meet all valid emissions limits is quite simply a much bigger technical challenge. We are in a constant and intensive dialogue with both U.S. agencies, the EPA and CARB, and we believe we have made significant progress in the recent weeks. But I trust you will understand that we can only announce our solution concepts for North America once these have been fully and finally coordinated also with the responsible authorities there. And this applies for the three generations of the TDI engine developed by Volkswagen, but it's also true for the V6 engine developed by Audi. Our customers in the US and Canada may rest assured that we will do everything we can to find technical solutions to fix the V6 engine as well, and that we will do this as swiftly as possible. Ladies and gentlemen, all our efforts to resolve the whole emissions issue are guided by one clear principle. There is to be as little inconvenience as possible to our customers, and this is what we guarantee to all of our customers. The technical solutions will, of course, be implemented free of charge. We waive any statute of limitation for the technical solution. If needed, we will provide appropriate substitute mobility, and we will also ensure transparent information for our customers at all times. I'll give you my word. Volkswagen will not rest until we have resolved this issue once and for all to the satisfaction of our customers.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the same time as the clarification process is progressing, we are also implementing the optimal solutions for customers. We are driving also the reorientation of the group resolutely forward. To avoid any misunderstandings here, I would like to make it clear that this realignment was on the cards sooner or later anyway, because the environment for our industry is rapidly changing, because we need new answers to new questions. But now we are speeding up this process. We are doing so as a result of the pressure of current events, of course, but also because there has never been a greater willingness in our group for change than there is at present. So even though this might sound like a cliché, this crisis is most definitely also an opportunity for Volkswagen, and we intend to seize that opportunity, truly. The transformation we are seeking is quite fundamental. It affects the group structures, our mindset, also something that is commonly referred to as corporate culture, and it affects the strategic targets that we set ourselves for the future. Now, does that mean everything at Volkswagen was bad in the past? No. It most definitely does not, because if that were the case, our brands and vehicles would not be so popular all over the world. The sense of solidarity among our workforce would not be the same, and we would not be in such a strong economic position. But it is precisely because things should stay that way, there has to be change. We presented an outline of our structure to you back at the end of September, and the starting point is the idea that a company of our size, our international dimension, our complexity, can simply not be managed according to yesterday's structures, particularly not in an environment like ours, which is changing so rapidly. There's new technologies, new competitors, new environmental challenges, and new customer needs. Volkswagen needs to align itself even more systematically to these developments. And I'm convinced that what we need now is for Volkswagen to truly embrace corporate responsibility from within. That is why the group will be decentralized to a greater extent. Decisions must be taken at the level where they're most meaningful. You know, in the world of politics, that is called subsidiarity. And we intend to adopt precisely this principle for ourselves. So, in specific terms, it means that our brands and regions are being given more autonomy and responsibility for their business. The group board of management no longer gets involved in operational fine-tuning. Instead, it will concentrate on its own core tasks, namely to drive forward the major overarching issues, to focus on synergies, on steering, and strategy. That will also impact how we approach the technological changes that have such a massive effect on our business model. But first and foremost, I'm talking here about electrification and the digital transformation. Now, our mission, my mission, is not to engage in a race to catch up, but to proactively shape these developments. But to do that, we must become more agile, more flexible, and we speed up our decision-making trajectories. Another goal of the new leadership model is we must become leaner and improve our cost efficiency. Now, one lever for that is to make the very best of leveraging the synergy potentials that this group undoubtedly has to offer. So here, I believe there's definitely room for improvement. Many of you may have asked in recent years whether meaningful management of this fast-growing global group is actually possible. And that is also something I am addressing here. All of these structural changes aim to reduce the complexity of steering functions and ensure the sustainable manageability of Volkswagen. Ladies and gentlemen, we can achieve that with the leadership structure you can see on this chart. There will be no longer a sales or a research and development and the production function at group board of management level. But that does not mean, of course, that these tasks are no longer performed. But there will be a new function in the very capable hands of Ms. Hohmann-Denhardt, namely integrity and legal affairs. This is a clear sign that much higher priority will be given to this issue in the future. And that is obviously true, particularly in the light of recent events. But our most valuable currency is not unit sales or operating profit. Our most valuable currency is credibility and trust in our brands and our products and in the people who work for this company. As we recently painfully discovered, unethical or illegal behavior destroys that trust. We have no intention of repeating that experience. On the right-hand side of the chart, you can see the brand groups for Audi and the luxurious sports cars. Here, we're bringing together what belongs together. We will leverage greater synergies through closer cooperation in the brand groups, just we were already doing in the truck and bus unit. China, as a region, will have its own group board member because of the crucial importance of this market for our company. Now, of course, this chart only provides a rough outline. It does not present the details and the underlying principles. Now, take my own function, for example. We are cutting the number of direct reports to the CEO from more than 30 to 19. So as a result, I will be able to concentrate more closely on the essentials. That includes digitization in particular. If you will, that's a topic for the boss. Obviously, I might be working on digitization on my own. You are aware, of course, that we've recruited Johann Jungwirth, an acknowledged expert and one of the few cross-border commuters who travel back and forth across the boundaries between the classical automotive business and the digital world of Silicon Valley. And we need people like that to successfully master the digital transformation. And something you can only guess from the structure chart as well is the scale of the staff reorganization that has already taken place in the group in recent months and that we have accelerated over the last 4 weeks. Now, that not only applies for the group board of management, as Mr. Pötzsch has pointed out, but also for large sections of top management. I have put together the most important changes here in this chart for you, and I believe the facts really speak for themselves. Since the beginning of 2015, there have been 6 out of 10 new appointments to the group board of management. 7 of our brands have new CEOs, and at the level of the brand board of management, there have been a total of 12 new appointments, and I have 7 new colleagues heading departments in my own function on the CEO level. And these will be our colleagues that have been added to the organization. So the team to tackle the challenges of the coming months and years is now in place. We will be working out the details of the new structure with this team in the first quarter of 2016. Or, to be more precise, we will be defining processes, appointing committee members and realigning the committees themselves, as well as setting out the details of the relationship between the group and the brands and the regions. The entire group will then be fully integrated in the new structure by the beginning of 2017. But that will not be enough to bring about the transformation we need. We can have the greatest minds and the best organization, but that is all in vain if we don't have the right mindset and the right mentality. So, when we talk about a new mindset, it is worth remembering that the Volkswagen Group has many strengths that we can build on and that indeed we want to preserve. Our deep-rooted quest for quality, the way our employees identify with our vehicles, the strong sense also of social responsibility that Volkswagen has always stood for.
teilweise auch Denkweisen
eingebürgert. At the same time, that some ways of thinking that I do not condone have also taken root here.
Das Verschweigen von
hierarchical thinking, departmental and brand egoism, covering up conflicts of interest or flaws. Well, we must put all that behind us. Instead, I would like to see more open discussion, arguments too, if that is what is needed to move forward. And I want to see better cooperation in our group. My aim is for us also to adopt a different approach, a constructive approach to mistakes in the future. Each one of us must take one thing on board. Mistakes are allowed, provided we understand them as an opportunity for learning. To achieve that, Volkswagen does not need yay-sayers, but rather managers and technicians who fight for their convictions, fight for their projects with good arguments. We have an entrepreneurial mindset and an entrepreneurial approach. So my appeal, therefore, is directed at the inquisitive, at the unconventional, at the pioneers, people who dare to follow their instinct and are not put off merely by the thought of the possible consequences of potential failure, now more than ever. So, in a nutshell, the future at Volkswagen belongs to the brave. You could say that we need a bit more of Silicon Valley coupled with our competence of Wolfsburg, Ingolstadt, Stuttgart and the other group locations. Obviously, the crucial question then is, how do we bring this new spirit to a group with 600,000 employees across the globe? But my answer is pretty pragmatic. Just do it. First, as the management team, it's our job to get on with it. Change can and change will only come about if we live this new openness from within, if we nurture, if we foster this new culture of mistakes and this new willingness for cooperation between the board and management. Second, we must breathe life into this new identity to make it tangible, both inside the company and externally. That calls for clear signals. Just doing the talking is not enough. We have to produce hard evidence that we have our feet firmly planted on the ground. And third, we must create new structures and platforms that specifically encourage this new collaborative exchange between our employees and in particular between employees and management. Over the past 2.5 months, we have already launched quite specific initiatives and measures that clearly demonstrate where we are headed. One example is our new open door policy. An office door that is open means open interaction. We want to encourage our employees to do the same. In any event, my door is always wide open. Another example is reforming our air services. It's true, a group like ours needs an efficient air service. But let us be honest, Volkswagen does not need its own Airbus, and this is why we will be selling the aircraft. And that also is part and parcel of the number of employees that travel the world. Many of our commissions and committees abroad were overstaffed, and if we streamline there, we need fewer people to travel by air. So, greater humility would also do as well at motor shows. I'm sure our products themselves can do all the convincing that is necessary, so they speak for themselves and convince also our customers. Now, here's another lever. We've begun streamlining our corporate committees and other bodies. I cannot allow dozens of highly paid experts to spend more time sitting on steering committees than working on key vehicle projects together with their own teams. Ladies and gentlemen, I sense the wish among the entire team to discover the wholehearted pride in their company, in our company. This is the best prerequisite for genuine, for sustainable change, such as that we are seeking to bring about now.
As I've already indicated, this change also includes redefining our targets. In other words, it also embraces our strategy. 8 years ago, we sent a very strong signal with our Strategy 2018, a signal to the automotive world, but above all, to our employees. Now, in terms of the key targets of our Strategy 2018, we were making good progress. And our Future Tracks program has already laid important foundations for a more sustainable future and greater efficiency. And we are now building on all of that. In the first step, we have defined three strategic focus topics for the group: digitization, sustainability, and integrity. We will now be bringing these topics to life step by step with the projects, among other things. We are currently planning a group-wide digitization campaign and a massive expansion of our electric fleet of vehicles with 20 additional electric cars and plug-in hybrids by 2020. So we will be ready to announce details soon. So we can say we are realigning Volkswagen now in terms of strategy and technology. We are delighted to welcome Thomas Cedren, who is one of the most respected managers in the auto industry, to help us do that. He will be spearheading the strategy process as it is driven forward. So, when we present our new Strategy 2025 in the middle of 2016, as announced, you will find the answers to questions such as how we intend to make the product portfolio of our brands even more forward-looking, even more profitable, how we can significantly increase our revenues outside the current core business, for example, through intelligent mobility services, or how we can utilize the digitalization potential better than existing and also new competitors, or how we can offer piloted driving on a wider scale earlier than other manufacturers do, or how we can repair our damaged reputation for sustainability, for example, with the e-campaign that I've just mentioned a moment ago, and also by integrating sustainability issues in our core business strategy. So, as you can see, we have not given up our claim to leadership in our industry, but we have given this claim a different definition. Our goal is to proactively shape the future of mobility with courage and determination. We will have to pull out all the stops to do that, but we most definitely have the potential. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to finish by summing up where we stand in overcoming the present crisis and realigning the Volkswagen Group. We're working hard on all of the 5 points we have set ourselves, and we are making good progress. We've made significant progress with point number one, i.e. helping our customers affected by the emissions issue as swiftly as possible. The technical solutions are in place, well, at least for Europe, and that's for the lion's share of the vehicles affected. Implementation of these solutions will begin in a few weeks. Point two on the list, clarification is also progressing, and we have already drawn far-reaching conclusions for the future. This clarification process will take some time. Incidentally, a comparison with similar cases in other companies, say, show that we are within the usual time frame. We're also moving forward fast with the third point, implementing the new structure. The team for the future is in place. Committees and processes will follow over the coming months. Well, it will take longer to firmly enshrine a new mindset in our group. We can have no illusions about that. But we're not wasting any time here either. And one thing I find particularly pleasing in many discussions and everyday situations, there is now a sense that people at Volkswagen are seizing the opportunities that new mindset brings. And they're setting out on this new path. And work on the fifth and final point, which is Strategy 2025, will be completed by mid-2016. I'm confident we will be presenting you with a very convincing concept. At the same time as we are addressing all these issues, we are of course also working very hard on day-to-day operations, and that is at present a particularly challenging task. Where does the Volkswagen Group stand economically today? Naturally, there has been plenty of print and speculation about the impact the crisis has had or could still have on our business. And we are watching that very closely, as you can imagine. But the big question is how our customers will react. Obviously, a scandal of this scale is bound to have repercussions. But experience from comparable cases also shows that deliveries following a severe crisis recover relatively quickly if, and this truly is the critical factor, if customer relations management is appropriate in the given situation. We're doing everything we can to guarantee that and to limit the fallout. So far, the positive news is that the massive slump that some feared earlier has not occurred. Our operational business is still in line with expectations. So today, 2.5 months after the crisis broke, we do not see any reason to change the adjusted annual forecast we issued at the end of October. At the same time, the picture for markets and brands is very mixed. Overall, the situation is certainly not dramatic, but as expected, it is tense. To put it plainly, we are fighting for every customer and for every car. Brand sales managers have launched measures to stabilize the situation. And if we succeed, and I'm cautiously optimistic that we do, then the impact on production will be within reasonable limits. If, however, despite all our efforts, that is not the case, we are in a position to respond appropriately at any time. As you're already aware, we have taken the first step with regard to investments. We have capped investments in property, plant and equipment at 12 billion euros for 2016. Now, that is 1 billion down on the average of previous years. But at the same time, we've also shortened the planning horizon by 1 year. So we're not planning too far ahead. One thing, though, is clear. Anything that is not absolutely necessary now will be cancelled or postponed. And we will definitely not be economizing on our future. And we're looking after our money because we cannot exactly estimate the financial consequences of the crisis. As you know, we've already made certain provisions. We are fortunate that Volkswagen has a very solid financial basis indeed. And we have also concluded additional credit lines to cover all contingencies. It's gratifying to note that our discussions have shown that Volkswagen's good reputation on the capital markets is still intact. And the most recent developments in our share price are also encouraging. Over the past 2 months, shares have recovered by around 40% from the low immediately following the outbreak of the crisis. Now, we see that as a sign that investor confidence is returning. Obviously, people believe we have the situation under control and can master the crisis with our own resources. And it will not come as a surprise to you that we see things pretty much in the same way. Ladies and gentlemen, even though the current situation is serious, the company will not go to pieces because of it. On the contrary, we have a clear mission. We want to create a new, a better, a stronger Volkswagen, a company that successfully makes the transition to the new automotive world based on its innate strengths, a company that now unleashes new energy and leverages its enormous potential even more effectively, and not least, a company whose clear values form the basis for sustained success. Thank you very much for your attention for the time being. Mr. Pötsch and myself would be pleased now to answer your questions.